Hi there. You know, we all want to make our photos look beautiful whilst also making them look realistic. And that is a really hard thing to do because raw files that we use are very flat. And so you want to add an element of depth into your photo editing to make your photos feel that little bit more three-dimensional. Make them feel that little bit more like you would have viewed the scene with some depth into it that your eyes produce. And so in order to do that, we need to use some contrast tools in our photo editing, but it might not be obvious what tools help us with that contrast because they're called some things that aren't very obvious. So we're going to dive into all of that today and give you some tips to make your photos look more three-dimensional. And to understand that first, you really need to understand what tonal contrast is. So I'm going to dive into that in a moment. If you already understand tonal contrast, you can jump ahead to this time in the video where we'll get straight into the photo editing. But for everyone else, what is tonal contrast? So there are lots of different types of contrast in photography, and we often just use the word contrast to represent whatever type of contrast it is we're talking about at that point in time. But in this case, I'm specifically talking about tonal contrast. And tonal contrast is effectively the difference in brightness, the difference between bright tones and dark tones. Not colours, but tones. So to understand this better, if you take any image and remove all the colour from it, convert it to grayscale, to black and white, then imagine a scale running from pure black to pure white and lots of shades of grey in between. Then, if you were to count up all the pixels at each level of brightness along that scale, you will get a tonal histogram. So if we pick any two tones on that histogram that are far apart, these tones have high tonal contrast, which means there's a lot of tonal difference between them. If we pick any two tones that are near to each other, there's not a lot of difference between them, so there's low tonal contrast. So now we understand tonal contrast, I'm going to dive into the photo editing, and I'm using Lightroom, but you'll be able to do all these things in whichever software you use. But just be aware that different software has different names for very similar tools. So here we are in Lightroom, and I've got a few photos to show you. Now, the first one is one that you'll have seen in my most recent video. So this is the raw conversion, so straight out of camera without doing anything to it. And actually, I didn't do a lot to this photo in the end anyway. What we've got is a photo that had pretty good contrast in it, and so I've barely changed anything in the final edit here. But this photo is a really good one to demonstrate the tools that we're going to talk about in terms of contrast and making your photo look more 3D and realistic. So the first one you'll probably know about, and that is the contrast slider. So up here we've got the contrast slider, and as we move it up, it increases contrast and down decreases contrast. So you'll probably already know that. But the contrast slider affects every part of the image exactly the same. So as we increase the contrast, it's increasing the contrast everywhere in the image. And as we decrease the contrast, it's decreasing it everywhere in the image. So it can be helpful in certain circumstances, but not always where you need it. So we're going to look at some other tools. And the first one, which might surprise you, is clarity. So clarity brings clearness to your photos as described, but how it's doing that is by altering the tonal contrasts. And unlike the contrast slider, the clarity slider affects the midtones more than the highlights. So if you look up in the top right hand corner here at the histogram, as I slide the clarity slider up, you'll see that it's pushing those midtones, the parts in the middle, out towards the edges. So it'll push towards the highlights over on the right and the shadows over on the left. So as I'm increasing the slider, you'll see it's pushing everything out on the histogram. And as I bring the slider down into negative clarity, it's pushing those extremes in. So in the middle here, as it was, pushes it out, and down here brings it back in again. So that is affecting the midtones more than the shadows and highlights. The next one we've got is texture. So texture affects parts of the photo where there are high contrast. So if we zoom in here and look at the bird, you'll see in its plumage, in its feathers, there's lots of contrast. There's patches of darks, there's patches of brighter ones. And so where you've got some pixels with dark things next to some pixels with bright things, they're the areas that texture targets. And it gives you that textured look by increasing the tonal contrast of just those areas. So as I increase the texture, you'll notice it doesn't affect the background. It only affects the bird and the rock. And that's because those are the areas that have got all these tiny details. So look here, right up at the far end, the background hasn't been affected at all, but the bird and the rock have. Let me reset that. So as I bring it up, it's just affecting the bird and the rock. And if I bring it back down, it's still just affecting the bird and the rock, but it's smoothing the bird and the rock out. So texture only affects the areas where there is already high contrast within a small grouping of pixels. So again, pay attention to the background here. The background is hardly changing at all, right up to the top, right down to the bottom. The background isn't changing, it's just the bird and the rock that is. So if any of you follow any portrait photographers or you've done any portrait photography yourself, you'll probably know that the texture slider is used by portrait photographers to smooth out their model's skin tones. So it was an important innovation when Lightroom brought it along, but understanding the way that the tool does what it does can help us wildlife photographers with our tonal contrasts and making things look more 3D. We'll get into that in a moment. Then the next area is dehaze. So you'll probably be familiar with dehaze if you've done any landscape photography. So with the dehaze slider, you can seemingly remove or at least vastly reduce any atmospheric haze that's in your image. But how it does that is to target the areas of low contrast in the photo and increase the tonal contrast. So it's doing the opposite of texture. So watch as I increase the dehaze slider. It's the background that's being affected there. And oh, that's horrible. As I decrease it, the background is being affected, but also the bird to a certain extent. But what this is doing is targeting mostly the areas that texture doesn't. So where there is lesser contrast, lesser tonal contrast, this is increasing that contrast and also the saturation to a certain extent. So that's how dehaze removes that haze in the landscape. But again, knowing how it does what it does, we wildlife photographers can use that to our advantage. And then the final set of tools are actually the exposure tools that we use normally. So the exposure slider, highlights, shadows, whites and blacks. So if I take a brush and paint on a shape here, I'll show you. So let's just do a big circle and we'll put a cross through it. So now, if I start playing around with some of those exposure tools, if I take the exposure slider and increase that, naturally, that area has got brighter. If I decrease it, it's got darker. But what I've also done here is increase the contrast between the areas that aren't painted and the areas that are. So if you think about it, you can use these tools in a really targeted way by using masks to increase or decrease the tonal contrast where you need to. So not just the exposure slider, you can use the other ones. If I use shadows, for example, it will do the same thing but have a lot less of a pronounced effect than using the exposure. Likewise, I could use the blacks or the highlights or something like that and alter those. So any of those exposure tools could be used in a really targeted way. So now that we've looked at what those different tools are, let's go on to apply those in a couple of photos that I need to edit and see how we can bring them to life, make them look more 3D. So the first one I want to look at is of a green woodpecker, and it's actually a juvenile green woodpecker. And I've got a couple of photos to choose from here. So I've got a green woodpecker juvenile on a wall, and both are on the wall. So in fact, let's just do a comparison view of the two. So those of you who watch the channel regularly will know that the green woodpecker is my favourite bird, and I've been really trying for the last couple of years to get some nice photos of juveniles because they look a little bit different. You see here, it's got this mottled plumage on its front, and it doesn't keep that for long. This kind of speckled, mottled plumage, by the time it becomes an adult, which happens really quickly, you'll see here that all of that is gone, and it's got a beautiful apple white front and a full red crown. But as a juvenile, both its front plumage and its crown plumage is kind of mottled. But what I really like about this particular photo is that the bird has just started to get some of its adult plumage come through. So you'll see here in this section, we've just got the first feathers of green coming through amongst that mottled plumage. Now, on the photo on the left, you see a little bit more of that green plumage coming through. But on the photo on the right, we've got more of the crown in the photo. So I think I'm probably going to edit the one on the right. Now, this photo was taken on a very flat light day, and so there's not a lot of contrast in this photo at all. So the more fully the clouds are covered and the thicker the cloud, the less contrast there'll be. And I know here we've also got some terrible dust spots that I need to get rid of up there. But in general, what I want to do with this photo is to create more contrast to give it a more 3D effect. Because it was on a very flat light day, the photo feels particularly flat. So you're looking here at the raw file conversion with absolutely nothing done to it. And so the first thing I'm going to do is increase the contrast of the bird and the wall that it sat upon. So let me do a selection. I'm going to go to masking and let it select subject, see what it finds. So it's just found the bird. So I'm going to add in an object and I will paint over the wall and hopefully it picks up all of the wall. So give me a moment just to paint that all in. And there we've got most of it, but there are a couple of bits that it's missed. So let me grab a brush and I'll just add those bits in at the bottom. But that's a fairly nice selection. So what I'm going to do with that selection is look to increase the contrast. And the first thing I'm going to do is increase the clarity. So remember that clarity is targeting those mid-tones. And so I don't want to increase it by much, but just a little bit. Maybe up to something like there. Yeah, that looks all right. And then the next thing I'm going to do is increase the dehaze. So remembering that the dehaze is targeting the low contrast areas. So I particularly want to pick up some more of the contrast in the wall just to give that a little bit more texture, surprisingly, that we're using dehaze to increase texture. But knowing that the dehaze slider is targeting the low areas of contrast, notice how it affects the wall. So let me just increase that and something like there. So here, this isn't looking great yet. We've got a long way to go. But if I turn this off and on, so I can go back to the original by pressing backslash. There's the original. That's what we've got. There's the original. That's what we've got. So you can see here how both the bird and the wall are starting to get some increased contrast. But there's now a little bit too much overall contrast in the bird and the wall together. So I'm going to go back up to the top to the contrast slider and just bring that down. So where I was using clarity and dehaze, I was targeting particular bits of the bird and the wall. Now I'm using the contrast slider, which affects everything. But in this case, it's only affecting everything from the selection that I've done. So it will reduce the contrast overall from the bird and the wall. So let me just bring that down a little bit to something like that. That's looking all right. So again, if I press backslash, that's the original. and now you can see the bird and the wall is starting to stand out from the background. But I also want to decrease the contrast in the background. So the background isn't bad, but you'll see we've got these dark spots up here that are a bit different from the bright spots over there. I want to reduce the contrast between those darker bits of the background and the brighter bits. So the easiest way to do that is to go to this mask that we've already done, the mask that covers the bird and the wall, and I'm going to click on the three dots and click duplicate and invert mask. So that now has done a mask of everything that wasn't masked before. So mainly the background, it's picked up some bits of the bird's feet, but I'm not too bothered about those. So you'll notice here that none of the sliders have been applied. It has only duplicated the selection. It's not duplicated where we've altered the sliders. So I can start from scratch with the background. And the first thing I want to do is to take down the clarity a little bit. So remember that clarity is targeting the midtones. So I'm going to bring down the clarity to, that's a bit much, something like there. And then I'm going to also bring down the dehaze, probably by a similar amount. Yeah, okay, that's looking all right. So I'm also going to bring down the contrast. Something like there. But that has now made it too bright. It looks a little bit odd. So I also need to bring down the exposure. So I'm just going to start gradually reducing the exposure to bring the colour roughly back to where it was before. So something like there, I think. So the colour should be a little bit similar to what it was to start with, but have reduced contrast between those dark areas and the bright areas. So let me just press backslash again. Yeah. Similar, but reduced contrast. So that's fine. So I think the final thing I need to do here is get rid of those dust spots. Well, let's move away from masking and go over to the healing section. And I'm going to turn on visualize spots. And if we adjust the slider there, we can see where all these dust spots are. So I'm just going to heal them all. Now you'll notice this one here near to the bird's foot. We need to be really careful with that because if we put the healing over the bird's foot, it's going to do something weird to the foot. Look there. So what I need to do is zoom in really close. So let's go up to something like 400%. And I just want to make sure, if I reduce the size of that brush, that I'm just outside where the bird's foot is. And click on that one. And now it's gone. So we've got rid of all of those nasty dust spots. But more importantly than dealing with the dust spots, what we've done is make the photo feel like it's got more depth. There's more tonal contrast there, which makes it feel more 3D. So let's go back to the original, fairly flat, and the final, fairly well toned. Fact, I think the only thing I might want to do is just go back to the background mask. And I think what I'm going to do is just add a little bit of saturation to it, just to bring some more of the colour through and make it similar to what we had at the start. And I think that looks all right. So original, fairly flat, edited, far more 3D. And that is a much better final image. You can feel like there's some depth there between the bird and the background. And there was a lot of depth there, but the depth wasn't apparent in the raw file because there was so little contrast because there was thick cloud cover. So as a final image, I'm quite happy with that. So other photo editing software than Lightroom will have similar tools to clarity, texture and dehaze, but they might call them other things. So You need to be aware of that and maybe look it up in the manual or on the website of the people that you bought that software from. And also, some of them have even cleverer tools, so there will be things like micro clarity and super contrast. And it's well worth diving in to the manuals or training videos, whatever it is that accompanies that software that you use. But importantly, you want to look up not just the tools that do contrast and have contrast in their name, but look up what all the tools do, because as we saw with Lightroom, with clarity, texture, and dehaze, those tools control contrast, but you wouldn't guess it from the name. So you want to understand not only what the tools are, but what it is they're actually doing to control the effect that they're creating. So the next photos I want to look at are of kingfishers. Now, I took two photos of kingfishers on the same morning. So the one on the left over here was taken fairly early in the morning and it was quite bright. So you can see here, there's quite a lot of contrast in the bird, quite a lot of shadow on its back, quite a lot of highlights on its front, and there's some nice shadow there cast onto the perch, onto the stick that it sat upon. So there's really good contrast there. The problem with this photo are some of these grasses here, like you can see, there's blurred out grasses that are causing a bit of a distraction. So I don't need to do an awful lot to this photo except raise the exposure. You probably know if you've seen my photo editing videos before, I always recommend when you're photographing Eurasian kingfishers, or the common kingfisher as it's sometimes called, that you underexpose because it's got these bright spots on its neck. And if you expose for the bird and the background, you can often find yourself blowing out those whites of its neck and it's impossible to recover. Whereas if you slightly underexpose, you can make sure that you retain those tiny patches of white. Now, this photo was taken on the same morning, but later in the morning. So the sun had risen somewhat, but also some cloud cover had come in. And so we've got reduced contrast here. Now, if you look at this post, you probably can't tell which direction the sun is shining from at all. There's very little difference between either side of the post. And in fact, when you look at the photo overall, that post could look like a cardboard cutout, really, because there's so little contrast. The only place you're getting any clues to the contrast whatsoever are from the bird. So you can see here, down this side of the bird, it's a little bit darker. And so we know that the sun must have been somewhere over to the right of the picture. And so with the post, this side of it that's facing away from the sun should be slightly darker. Now it is slightly darker, but ever so slightly, and you can't really tell. And so what we want to do to give it that more 3D feel is make this side of the post darker. So let's go on to edit that photo. But the first thing I'm going to do is target the kingfisher. So let me mask and select the subject and see what it finds. So it's picking out both the bird and the post. So I'm going to subtract an object and I'm just going to brush around the post and say, take that away, don't want it. Not that bothered about the bird's feet, it's more its plumage. So I'm going to paint over everything. See what it finds. And there we've got a selection of the bird. So I just want to give it a little bit more contrast to add a little bit of texture into the plumage and help the bird stand out. So I'm going to come down to clarity and I'm going to raise that ever so slightly, not by much. Remembering clarity is targeting the mid-tone. So if I go all the way, look where the clarity is targeting and that looks bad. But just a little bit is really helping. Something like that. And then I am going to increase the texture also. So remembering that the texture is targeting areas where there's already high contrast. So it's going to pull out some of these bits here where you can see some variation in the tones of the plumage. So let's just increase the texture a little bit. Something like there. Yep, 16 I like. In fact, let me take it all the way up and you can see which areas it's targeting. So particularly that area there on the bird's breast, but I don't want it that much. Something like 15, 16, I think we were at, looks absolutely fine. So let's just look at original and then with the bird edited. It's subtle, but it's making a difference. And now I'm going to target the post. So I'm going to create a new mask, selecting the object. But what I want to do is just target this side of the post. So I'm going to decrease the brush size. I'm just going to brush around the bits of the post that are facing in the same direction as the bird, but facing away from the sun, really. Because they should all be in shadow. And it's done quite a good job. But you'll notice here, we've also, because the post is broken, we've got a bit here that's facing towards the sun, and then we've got another bit here that should be facing away from the sun with the way that wood has broken. So I'm going to just add another object and see if we can just pick out with that what we need. So let me brush that on, see if it can figure it out. And it's done a really good job. I might just paint a little bit more in with a brush just to get a bit there. And I think that then has got it all. So now let's work on the post. Now, as we mentioned earlier, you don't have to just use the contrast slider or texture clarity and dehaze. You can use the exposure sliders to alter the exposure and therefore the contrast. So I do want to give it a little bit of clarity. So just to target those mid-tones, let's bring that up a little bit. In fact, maybe something like there looks fine. And now I'm going to reduce the shadows. So make that area a little bit darker. So maybe something like that. And I'm also going to reduce the contrast. So I don't want there to be too much contrast within the selection. I just want the selection to contrast with the other areas around it. So let me reduce that contrast down to something like that. And then I'm going to bring the exposure down also. So again, remember it's targeting only that area that I selected. So let's just do this gradually. We don't want to do too much. And I think that's looking all right. So now if I press backslash and show you the original. So there we are. It's feeling very flat. And the edited, original, and edited. You'll see there it's feeling more 3D. Because we've done what used to be called dodging and burning effectively. So in the days of film photography, they would take some particular chemicals and rub them over bits of the photos that they wanted to brighten or darken. In this case, we're doing it digitally. It's effectively the same as dodging and burning, but we are making the photo feel more 3D by increasing the tonal contrast between the part of the post facing away from the sun and the part of the post facing the sun. But as I discussed earlier, the photo is ever so slightly underexposed. So I want to go back to the overall sliders that affect not just the selection, but everything. And I'm just going to bring the exposure up ever so slightly. That looks fine. Didn't need too much. And maybe just add a little touch of vibrance. And that's feeling good. And I think I've just got a dust spot to deal with over here. Look, we've got maybe a couple of them up here. So let's go to the healing. And I don't need the visualized spots for this because I can see them. I'm going to drop one in there, one there, and one there. And they are our dust spots dealt with. So now all I need to do is denoise this photo and we've got a final image. So we saw there a fairly nice photo of a juvenile green woodpecker. And as I mentioned before, I've been trying to get close to juvenile green woodpeckers for a couple of years. It's not easy because they don't stay in that plumage for long. But if you are interested in how to scout out subjects like that, you might want to check out this video here. Hope you found that useful. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you next time.